بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين والصلوات والسلام سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل أعوذ برب الناس مالك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ونعوذ بك من سوء إسرار الناس وحتم الصائرة وأن يستحوذ علينا شيطان وينكبنا زمان أو يتحدى منا سلطان. صدق الله العلي العظيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to have my dear Sheikh Ali Rashid here with us today. So let's give a salawat to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for having him here with us today. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. As any student who stands before one of his both his friends and family to give a small presentation, I am humbled and quite nervous that my teacher is here sitting directly in front of me today. But inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept these words with the intent of his pleasure, and inshallah being beneficial to myself first, because I know that I must address myself before I address anyone else, inshallah. This short surah that we recited, Surah Nas, in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, say, I seek refuge in the Lord of men, the King of men, the God of men, from the evil of the whisperings of the slinking shaitan, who whispers into the hearts of men, from among the jinn and the men. Very short, compact surah, but has a gravity, and is a weighty meaning of us being Muslims, and I have to say particularly here in North America. And this short dua that was recited after, it is actually the in the eighth dua of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam in the Sahifa Sajidiyya. And the premises of this dua is seeking refuge from the hateful things and bad moral qualities. And as we gave a khutbah several months ago now, we said that this particular dua is a commentary of Surah Falaq. But when you look at the content of this dua, it is actually an extensive commentary of Surah Falaq and Surah Nas. So we're going to take some brief points from this dua and kind of, you know, speak on those quickly, inshallah. In this dua, the Imam says, we seek refuge from ill-mindedness, looking down on the small, and Satan's gaining mastery over us. Also, times afflicting us, and the sovereigns oppressing us. In the last khutbah, which was, I think it was right before Shahr Ramadan, we said, the Imams Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salam, we know them to be infallible. But we know that this does not mean that they were not aware of sin. It's just that, or that they could not sin. It's just that through their God consciousness, they stayed away from it. They were averted from the path of sin. And so we, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salam, we have adopted that path because we know the best path and the most direct path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we take today, we know that if you take a GPS, that GPS, if you've had it updated, it will give you the most direct course to where you want to go. And we know the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, they have been that direct course for over 1,000 years. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us on that path. A few points of refresher. We mentioned that each dua of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam has its own particular purpose. Each word is constructed in a particular way, and each dua has a particular aim. And this particular dua being a treaty or a guidance against negative forces. We mentioned why three of the big religions have survived, namely Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Judaism has basically thrived through oppression, whether it's oppression in Gaza, oppression here in North America by control of media, the clothing markets, entertainment. All those ways, all those things have been ways to oppress the masses and keep us away from truth. As I was on the way here, I was listening to a madrasah by Sheikh Ahmed Hanif. And what he said was, he mentioned the hadith by, I think it was Imam Ali, alayhi salam, or Imam Jafar. He said, if you follow the media will have you believing that which is true to be a lie, or that which is a lie to be the truth. And as we see now, or has been, you know, particularly after the martyrdom of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the media has always been constructed in a way to keep people from going in the right direction. That's why we must always keep our GPS and stay attached to the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. When in reference to Christianity has survived basically through financial tools, whether it's monies or the threat of hell by way of not paying your tithes. A lot of people feel coerced into following a particular way. Plus, Christianity of today is not the Christianity of yesterday. Christianity of yesterday was actually Islam, because the true path of Christianity was a path of Tawheed. But over the course of years, after the Treaty of Nicaea, Christianity took a paganistic, went more towards a paganistic route. And through the teachings of the Pauline scriptures, Christianity indoctrinated people in a way that instead of elevating ourselves to God, we brought God down to us. And therefore, we were able to do what we wanted to do versus doing what God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will have us to do. Isa, alayhi salam, in the Bible, according to the Bible, he said, he that is sent is not greater than he that sendeth him. So a question I would like to ask, is it plausible for a master craftsman who has all the tools at his disposal, all the finances, no budget, the utmost knowledge of a particular craft, is he in need of a student to coach through a particular project? The answer ultimately is no. However, if that teacher or that master craftsman wants to uplift that student and bring awareness to others, then he will send him to guide others to his patool, to the right way. And I have to revert and kind of read a little bit. Now, if I want to uplift that student, if I want to uplift that student and bring awareness to others about my project, and actually want to guide those who are interested in the craft to learn, become masters of it, then I will send a recruiter or instructors for that particular purpose. Granted, in this particular case, the student would never outrank his instructor. How many of you have seen the movie Ip Man about the teacher of Bruce Lee?
Ip Man.
Yeah. Ip Man was the teacher of Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee came to him as any video kid. But he nurtured Bruce Lee in a way that Bruce Lee overshadowed him. Because he got into media, he started making movies. His art forms was being taught worldwide. So as of late, we began to know about Ip Man because of the movie. But in this particular case, does Imam Ali, alayhi salam, outrank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. Does the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does he outrank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No, he doesn't. However, they're the masters of their craft. However, they're the guides to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the chain of Imams up to Imam Zamana, jalallahu ta'ala, Faraj al-Sharif, they take us to Muhammad Ali Muhammad. They take us to the master, the architect of this craft, the craft of ethics, the craft of brotherhood, teaching, the craft of beautifying ourselves for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With Islam, we say that a major component of why Islam has survived is because Islam has is teaching us on a continual basis the art, the beauty, the nature of self-sacrifice. Giving of ourselves, not for ourselves, because what we're doing is trying to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To the extent that when Imam Ali alayhi salam died, they said he had no wealth. Even though he had the entire treasury of the Ummah at his disposal, he had no wealth. They gave it all away. So that's the path that we must adopt. That's the path that the Imam is speaking about in this beautiful dua, where he's asking us to seek refuge for the negative things. And by seeking refuge from those negative things, what happens? We flourish, we grow, we exemplify all that which is beautiful. We are ambassadors of the religion of Islam, the correct teachings of Islam. Because we all know that there's an alternate path in Islam. And that path has been obscured. That path has been derailed. That path has been muddied. That path is sullen. It leads to darkness. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Ayatul Kursi, where he brings the darkness into the light, this path takes the light into the darkness by killing the heart. Salawatullah Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
In this dua, the Imam says, wa na'udhu bika min su'i sarira. We seek refuge in thee from ill-mindedness. The word translated as ill-mindedness, sarira, comes from the root word which means absent-minded, forgetful, not keeping our duties in mind as Muslims, as Shia, Allahu Akbar, Salatu Wassalam. What is our purpose? When we are born, even a child comes into this world in his infancy, he knows that his mother has a purpose. The purpose of that mother is what? To nurture that child. And that, you know, we're looking at a documentary. I think it was a kangaroo or a possum or something of that nature. Comes out about so big, maybe a couple inches. But instinctively, when that baby is birthed inside of that pouch, instinctively, that baby comes out and climbs up to the breast of its mother. It knows that there's a purpose in the very way that it was born, and it seeks out that purpose. It knows that its mother has a particular purpose, so Allah has built it inside of that child to seek that purpose, to be guided towards that purpose. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I have a bad habit of writing when I'm driving, so I have things kind of scattered all over the place. So maybe I need to not do that. They have a no text while I drive law, so maybe I need to have a no writing while driving law. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So I must ask a question. Hajime, how long have you been Muslim? Rhetorical question. Hajimunda, how long have you been Muslim? Yet again, it's a rhetorical question. What's your name, brother?
Abdus-salam.
Abdus-salam? As-salamu alaykum. How long have you been Muslim? Rhetorical question. No need to answer. But the prevailing question is, are we Muslim? Do we renew our Shahada daily when we say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and for those who say Ashhadu anna Aliyyun wa Waliyullah? Do we renew our covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a daily basis? Do we think about it? Or are we busy with our daily lives? You know how when we get that phone call, phone rings, bring, bring, and we look at the call ID, oh, I get that later. Do we treat our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that way? When Allah makes a call to us, are we answering that call? When Allah calls us to that which is beautiful, do we answer it? Or do we hit ignore and put it down, or put it on silent and go away? Or when we receive that text message, Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
O servant of Allah. Do we reply to that text message? Or we say, I'll get back to you? Are we renewing our covenant so that our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to grow and to flourish? Are we Muslim? Are we reaching the state of Iman? Are we looking to be mu'min? Are we striving to be mutaqi? Are we on that continual path of growing, of being nurtured, of nurturing ourselves and nurturing our brothers in this faith? Are we being encouraging to one another? Are we being good examples to one another? Do we wear our feelings on our shirt sleeves when we must, or when someone is asking us, brother, do you know you could have done this thing better? Have you thought of doing this thing another way? Can we approach one another in a way that out of love, out of kindness, out of dutifulness, in a way that we grow, that we are beautified, that we become beautiful, that we help others become beautiful? Or are we taking a path of darkness? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. A few months ago,
Hajj mother gave a khutbah in which he spoke about his relationship, I believe, with one of his co-workers. And he was talking about dawah. It was about 4 months ago. And it was very interesting because his khutbah and his conversation with one of his co-workers ran parallel with one of my conversations and a relationship I was having with one of my co-workers. And about 9 months ago, I was changed from one department to another. And so I was made aware that there was a preacher, well, a pseudo preacher maybe. Just I guess I'm the pseudo sheikh for the day. But that his mission was to convert me. He said, I'm gonna convert that guy. So every day I went to work, I was swiping the clock. Is this gonna be the day that I become converted or revert back to Christianity versus being Muslim? But that day never came. So I would go to my office, I would turn off my light, lock my door, make my salah. But every day for 4 months, I was asking myself, is this the day? Is this the day? Is this the day? So about the same week or the week prior to Hajj Munder's khutbah, I swiped the clock and that day came. And I got a nice little article, and it was from a magazine. It's called Decisions. Do Christians and Muslims worship the same God? Very, very interesting title. So he said, take this, I want you to read it. And I said, no, I'm not really interested. We're not interested. Why not? You might find it interesting because it's probably something that we've already read before. Because when it comes to the dawah or what's being given or related by Christians about Islam, it's the same thing over and over again. There's nothing new within their quote-unquote dawah or their Muslim stories that has been original or new. There's no weight and no gravity to it. But to the article. So as we began to peruse it, there was a story about Turning to the True God by a young man who was Muslim, and he converted to, or reverted, or changed his mind and became Christian. So took about 6 minutes, 7 minutes, read through the article. And within the article, you can read or see that one, either the person was never Muslim. Two, if he was Muslim, he never was Muslim, meaning that he just kind of went through the motion. Was as a kid, his dad took him to the masjid, and he saw some people prostrating, but he never did any research, he never did any reading, he never applied himself into his own nurturement as far as identifying with being Muslim, or he did not seek a path for himself. If he did get information, it was, what this guy said, what that guy said, what daddy said, what mommy said. It wasn't something that he placed inside of his heart where he believed what he went through or what he was experiencing or what he had, what he was exposed to. But within this, in the same article, there are some interesting Thou appoint, where it said, it gave 10 ayahs from Quran. And when you look, he said, what about these verses? I want you to go home. And he said, do you have a Quran at home? I said, yes. He said, well, I want you to, look these up, because I think these are very interesting, readings from the Quran. And, during Shah Ramadan, we try to read the entire Quran during that month. So we read through the 10 verses. Well, that's not accurate. That's not correct. And that's not right. And that's not right. That one's close, but, it's a little iffy. So to belabor the, not to belabor the point, we take the book home, or the article home. We research it. We take the ayats that supposedly are correct from his article and write down the ayats that are actually in the Quran. Draw a line in the middle of the paper. This, your Quran, your passage says this. The Quran actually says that. Yours says this. The Quran says that. Yours says this. The Quran says that. This says that. This is the truth of what your people are saying is in our book. So I tell him this, but I give him this. Take this home, read it. I said, do you have an internet at home? You have a computer? Yeah. Tell you what, Google the Quran. Look these verses up for yourself. And when you see, you'll see that we're not falsely attributing anything to the Quran, but placing what is proper side by side to what your organization is putting out. Excellent, excellent verses for dawah. Because they ask, what does the Quran say about Isa? One of the verses that he had there, which was incorrect, was that verse. So now he has to bear witness that he knows the truth about the relationship of Isa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It says, what does the Quran say about Isa? It says, the similitude of Isa is like the similitude of Adam. The likeness of Isa, the likeness of Jesus, is like the likeness of Adam. We said to him, be, and he was. He is our creation. He is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now he knows that. Now he has to bear witness. But the prevailing point was not only that, just sharing the Quran, is that by our conduct, now this guy, he's one of my better employees. When he would formally throw rages and throw equipment and do what he wants to do, now he has to be called. Now he's being called on his behavior. I expect different from you. You're not like this guy. You're a preacher.
New knowledge.
Our conduct is supposed to bring these guys to the, to doing things correctly. I don't expect for you to have an attitude. If I ask you to do something, I expect you to do it. Why? Because your book tells you to do so. Our attitude is supposed to exemplify something different. Even though we have different faith, if we're men of God like we say we are, then we're supposed to be just a tad bit different. So now this guy, he's presenting himself in a different way, and I don't have to worry about being converted again.
It's nice.
So, but also, in a very delicate but very firm way, I appreciate you getting, I did share it with my wife, the kids, had to have a talk with the kids. You will be presented with this type of information. Read about your religion. Don't just go and listen to Haji Munda give a talk, Google a YouTube Sheikh Ali, and Sheikh Usama Abdul Ghani. We have to read for ourselves, because that's a part of the labor. That's a part of, getting into your hearts, is when you read. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ikra, listen to Rabbah Khaladi Khalak, read in the name of your Lord. Reading is fundamental. Even when you do math, balancing your checkbook, you have to read those numbers. If you don't read those numbers properly, but you got a bad day coming at the end of the month, right? So what there was, this publication is purposely, intentionally putting out misinformation about Muslims. Now it's your responsibility to correct it. So this publication has no credibility. Google the Quran, Google these verses, and see what the Quran says. So, salawat Allah Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. O Allah, we pray and beseech thee to have mercy upon us and guide us and keep us on the right path. O Allah, we pray and beseech thee to make us dutiful and perform our duties as courageous, strong, firm Muslims. O Allah, we pray and beseech thee that we may be ambassadors of your religion and that we may be keep ourselves partaken by the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this holy Ahlulayt alayhi wa sallam. Salam wa ta'ala Muhammad wa alayhi Muhammad wa qawmat wa sallam.
Allahumma sallam.
Thank you.